A vagina is a muscular tube. It is a potential space or tube. Someone once described it to me as a glove without a hand in it. It's very elastic. The walls can stretch enough so that a baby can be born through it. It's about 4 inches deep, and only the outer third has nerve endings. So if a vagina is about 4 inches long and the outer third has the nerve endings, how many inches in from the outside of the vagina are there nerve endings? That would be about an inch and a third. So if a male has a penis that is about an inch and a third long, he is good to satisfy a vagina. There are also two sets of muscles, the sphincter vagini and the levator ani. This slide speaks for itself. Women should do self-examinations. They should use a mirror and examine their labia and outer part of the vagina and check for anything unusual. Anything against the norm should be checked into and care given. Vaginismus is a condition where women cannot have control over the muscles surrounding their vaginal opening. Basically, they are so fearful of penetration for one reason or another that they cannot relax enough to have intercourse. So this can happen from just fear of pregnancy. Maybe they have been sexually abused. Maybe they've never had sex before and they've been told it's going to hurt. And so they just involuntarily tighten that muscle, and it does make penetration difficult or even impossible. The pubic coccygeus muscle, try saying that 3 times fast in a row, is the inner muscle of the vagina that women do have control over. I prefer to call it the PC muscle just because that's easier to spell and say. And women, when they become pregnant, they will be taught about doing Kegel exercises. Kegels are where they tighten that muscle. And so to know which muscle that is, pretend you're sitting on the toilet and squeeze the muscle that's going to stop the flow of urine. That is your PC muscle. So women, when they're pregnant, they need to practice that, because when they have the baby, their vagina is going to be greatly expanded, and they're going to want to get that back in shape as soon as possible once the baby is born. So just basically hold it for 5 seconds, release, hold it for 5 seconds, release, and do this for 10 repetitions. Or you can even do a quick hold, release, all in a row. So there's a couple different exercises that women can do to keep their PC muscle in shape. Another reason, besides getting your vagina back in shape after the birth of a baby, would be when you get to be older and have a full bladder, you want to be able to hold that until you can go to the restroom. So that's the same muscle. So when we get older, we want to be able to practice those exercises every day from the time we're pregnant until we are older. So we're gone, I guess, to make sure we keep that muscle in great shape. Vaginitis is an infection of the vagina. You probably know it more so as yeast infection. This is not a sexually transmitted disease because you do not have to have sex to get it. Women who have diets high in sugar often are prone to yeast infection. And how you might know it, you might have an itch in your vagina, might be burning, also a yeasty smell because of the amount of yeast. And when we bake bread, we add yeast to the bread to help it rise, and the sugar feeds the yeast. So that would be the connection with a diet high in sugar. Women who douche, we'll be talking about douching in class, not recommended, but that basically destroys the good antibodies in the vagina that helps keep it healthy. So if you destroy those, women might be more prone to getting a yeast infection. Antibiotics, when you're an antibiotic, that destroys all the bacteria in your body, and so you're going to even destroy the good bacteria in the vagina, because the vagina has its own defense mechanism that keeps it healthy. So if you destroy that with antibiotics, then that will take away the opportunity to keep your vagina healthy. Oral contraceptives may put a woman at risk. A moist vaginal environment, swimmers, women who wear a lot of spandex may be more prone to becoming infected with a yeast infection or vaginitis. Turn to page 51 of your text, or the next slide will show you the different types of hymens. Basically, it's a protective tissue just inside the vaginal opening. Most girls, their hymen will stay intact till sex, but some do not. Some, they're torn accidentally, excessive exercise, horseback riding. Some are torn by using a tampon. Some girls are even born with an incomplete hymen. So the theory is that in order to be a virgin, you still need to have an intact hymen. It's not true, because women may not have an intact hymen even though they are virgins. History, they would deflower. Women, defloration, basically destruction of the hymen. In some cultures, there's even ceremonies where they tear these for young girls so that they're already torn before sex. And an interesting fact, from 1920 to 1950, some women had gynecologists put in stitches. If they already had been sexually active, they would have them put in a stitch within the labia so that it would hurt upon intercourse once they were married. And that was called the lover's knot. Some different names for hymens: the annular, that's the most common. The cribriform, it's a web of tissue. Septate, just basically a single band of tissue. And then imperfor, it would be no opening. So the next slide will show these. You can see the cribriform, it looks like a little turtle or web. The annular is totally open. So this girl may be born like this. Intercourse pain upon first intercourse would not be as great for her. Septate, the one strand of tissue down the middle, and the imperforate. The imperforate can even cause problems for baby girls, because that would trap urine, and it wouldn't breathe like it normally should, so they might become irritated in the vaginal area, and the doctor may need to open it, take a wooden spatula, an instrument, and just open that so that it can breathe better, so urine will not get trapped and the area become inflamed. Acute urethral syndrome, cystitis, honeymoon disease, bladder inflammation. Probably you know all of these as UTI, a urinary tract infection. And the reason it's called honeymoon disease would be because of all the sex that honeymooners have. And just the bacteria, we learned in class that peeing after sex will not keep us from becoming pregnant. However, peeing after sex is not a bad thing, because it keeps the urethra cleansed. Acid from the urine would help with that, help rinse out the bacteria so that a woman may not be prone to getting bladder inflammation. Again, this is not an STD, because you do not have to have sex to get it. However, you can pass it back and forth to one another. So if one of the partners gets a urinary tract infection, you need to totally get cleared up before you have sex again, or at least use a condom so you do not infect one another. It's an infection of the urethra and the bladder. You definitely want to get it treated so it does not spread to go to the kidneys. You will feel like you have to urinate, but yet you don't want to, because it's going to burn. And then, of course, there can be pain during intercourse as well. Some precautions to keep from getting cystitis would be to always drink lots of water so the urethra is being flushed out when you urinate, less alcohol. Drink cranberry juice. In fact, some people treat with cranberry juice. It's very high in acid. However, if that works for you, great. If it doesn't, you do need to go to the doctor so that you can get this condition cleared up. You do not want it to be left untreated and then spread to the kidneys. Other things you can do are wash your hands before touching the genitals, wash your hands before and after intercourse, prevent touching the vulva after touching the anus. Little girls, when they are being taught to wipe themselves for good hygiene, are taught to wipe from the front to the back. She doesn't want what's been in her anus up in the vulva area. Urinate after intercourse to wash away any bacteria at the urethra opening. Now, this does not keep you from becoming pregnant, but it does cleanse the urethra. Bacteria can build upon intercourse around the urethra, so if you urinate afterwards, then that keeps that bacteria clean. When you go to the bathroom, totally empty your bladder.
And don't take bubble baths or get into a hot tub while you're infected. And then there are some over-the-counter drugs that you can buy, Azo Standard, Azo Cran, or Urostat are three that I know about. And then remember that bladder inflammation, UTI, is not an STD. You can pass it sexually, but you can get it without having sex.
Here are a bunch of V words all surrounding the vagina. Vulvodynia is pain, especially upon intercourse. Vaginal atrophy, that's where the inner surface of the vagina shrinks, especially in older women. High levels of estrogen keep our vagina supple, more elastic. And so once we're older, we get lower levels of estrogen, and so that creates a problem. Varicose veins, basically varicose veins is a bulging vein. Most of the time women would get those on their legs, but it can get up into the vulva area. Vaginal atresia, congenital means they're born with that, so they're just born without an opening to the vagina. And sometimes this is not discovered until puberty. And then vaginal fistula is an abnormal opening where the bladder, urethra, or rectum all connect into one opening. This can be as a result of being born that way or from sexual abuse. The next female structure we're going to talk about is the uterus. And when you hear the word womb, I bet you think of baby. Basically, the uterus is where the fertilized ovum implants. And once a woman becomes pregnant and develops, then until the baby is born. The endometrial lining is what forms and basically creates an atmosphere where the fertilized egg can be nourished until the placenta takes over. So once a woman is pregnant, that embryo will attach to the uterine lining. And so when she's pregnant, typically her periods stop because that endometrium has a purpose. If she's not pregnant, the endometrium does not have a purpose and will be shed as her period. The tipped uterus is just displaced from its usual position. Your book says it has no effect on a woman's ability to become pregnant, although I've heard women say they had problems getting pregnant because they have a tipped uterus. The cervix is the neck of the uterus. The opening is called the os, and that must remain closed during pregnancy until labor. A girlfriend of mine in high school had to have her cervix sewn shut once she became pregnant for both her pregnancies because it wouldn't stay shut and the baby risked falling out. So I've heard of that situation in more instances than that one. During labor, then, you will dilate, and that will go from a fourth inch to 4 inches. 4 inches is dilated to a 10 centimeter, and that's when the baby will be born. Cervical cancer is the number two killer, second to lung cancer. We've already talked about the opportunity of HPV. You probably know more likely as genital warts. Girls being at risk for cervical cancer if they've had that, and the Gardasil shot that we have to help protect that. Other risk factors that women might have to get cervical cancer would be if they've had a history of pelvic inflammatory disease or STDs, 10 or more sex partners, a partner that has had multiple partners, and then early initiation of sexual intercourse. You've already learned from our drag and drop that the uterine wall consists of three layers, the perimetrium, the outer layer that holds it all together, the myometrium, this is the muscle, middle layer, myometrium, muscle, that contracts during childbirth and is responsible for orgasm and expelling the menses. That cramping that we feel when we have our periods, we can thank the myometrium for that. It's not totally a bad thing, although cramps are not something us women enjoy. Then the endometrium is the inner layer that's partially shed during our menstrual cycle if there is not a fertilized egg implanted. If there's a fertilized egg, then the endometrium nourishes until the placenta takes over. Uterine cancer, and there are other disorders that evolve around the uterus and the ovaries. Cervical, intraepithelial, neoplasia, would be precancerous or early cancer cells. This is what a pap smear would help to detect. And then advanced